We encounter patients with dry eye in our practice on a daily basis. The symptoms may range in severity and may not reflect the signs that we see. According to a study by Lemp in 2012, evaporative dry eye accounts for 86% of all the cases of dry eye that we see. Because of its prevalence, we wanted to do a three-part series on clinical insights to investigate meibomian glands, the diagnosis, and the treatment of MGD. We want to credit Investigative Ophthalmology and Vision Science and the TFOS group for their excellent publication and hard work on MGD. We used them as a source for much of our research and some of our images that we're showing here. Meibomian glands were first described by Heinrich Meibom the Younger in 1666. There are some 30 glands on the upper lid and about 26 on the lower. The glands are longer in the middle of the upper lid than they are on the lower lid, but the width of the gland on the lower lid tends to be wider. Each gland is made up of a central duct that has acini attached to them. Acini are a special type of sebaceous gland. The number of secretory acini in a meibomian gland is around 10 to 15, higher in the upper lid, and the difference of secretory capacity of the upper lid versus the lower lid hasn't been investigated. However, Korb and Blackie have shown that the glands in the nasal region of the lid excrete the most oil. As meibom is generated, it fills the acini and moves along the central duct towards the surface, but it is the blink that releases the meibom onto the ocular surface. Near the terminal portion of the central duct, there are various striated fibers of Ryland's muscle, which have split from the orbicularis muscle and encircle the duct. During the blink, the orbicularis and Ryland muscles work to release an oily meibom onto the lid margin. Working in tandem with each other, they create almost a milking type of action, which helps to hold the meibom in and then release it upon a solid blink. Although there are many reasons for glands to lose their quality over time, we believe that one of the primary causes of the meibomian glands getting plugged is because the orbicularis and the Ryland muscles are not being activated as often or as completely as they should. In other words, we don't think that people blink enough, and when they do, they don't blink completely. Two individuals that we have come to respect immensely looked at the number of glands that were expressed and found a correlation to comfort. What Korb and Blackie did in their 2008 paper was show how clinicians can standardize our evaluation process. Korb and Blackie evaluated 133 subjects. They looked at the patient's symptoms and evaluated the amount of meibomian glands yielding liquid secretions. Using an instrument that we can get from Tear Science, they exerted 1.25 grams per millimeter squared of pressure to express the glands. 1.25 grams per millimeter squared is key because that's about the most pressure that a patient can exert on their own glands when they blink deliberately and forcefully. After evaluating all of their patients, they found that those that had 5 or fewer liquid secreting meibomian glands were highly correlated with symptoms of dry eye. What this tells us is that the evaluation of the meibomian glands is a critical aspect of our dry eye exam. We should be utilizing an instrument that can standardize the pressure, and when we see that they are 5 or fewer secreting glands, we should treat whether the patient is symptomatic or not. What Korb and Blackie's data shows us is that if they're not uncomfortable yet, they may be soon. We know that an aggressive approach to dry eye disease in its earliest state may not only help a patient be less symptomatic, but might also help by slowing down the progressive nature of the disease. This will help us to transform eye care and improve our patient's quality of life. And that's ultimately why we do what we do.